Hachette Audio presents Dragon, Book 10 in the Dirk Pitt series, written by Clive Cussler and read by Scott Brick. To the men and women of our nation's intelligence services, whose dedication and loyalty are seldom recognized, and whose efforts have saved American citizens from more tragedies than can be imagined and never revealed. Denning's Demons. August 6, 1945. Shemya Island, Alaska. The devil clutched a bomb in his left hand, a pitchfork in his right, and smirked impishly. He might have appeared menacing if it wasn't for the exaggerated eyebrows and the half-moon eyes. They gave him more of a sleepy gremlin look than the fiendish expression expected from the ruler of hell. Yet he wore the customary red suit and sprouted regulation horns and long forked tail. Oddly, the claw-like toenails of his feet were curled over a gold bar that was labeled 24K. In black letters above and below the circled figure on the fuselage of the B-29 bomber were the words Denning's Demons. The aircraft, named for its commander and crew, sat like a forlorn ghost under a sheet of rain driven southward over the Aleutian Islands by a wind from the Bering Sea. A battery of portable lights illuminated the area beneath the open belly of the plane, casting wavering shadows from the ground crew on the glistening aluminum body. Flashes of lightning added to the haunting scene, stabbing the darkness of the airfield with disturbing frequency. Major Charles Dennings leaned against one of the twin tires of the starboard landing gear, hands shoved deep into the pockets of his leather flight jacket, and observed the activity around his aircraft. The entire area was patrolled by armed MPs and canine sentries. A small camera crew recorded the event. He watched with uneasy trepidation as the obese bomb was delicately winched into the modified bomb bay of the B-29. It was too large for the bomber's ground clearance and had to be hoisted out of a pit. During his 2 years as one of the top bomber pilots in Europe, with over 40 missions to his credit, he had never laid eyes on such a monstrosity. He saw it as a gigantic, overinflated football with nonsensical boxed fins on one end. The round ballistic casing was painted a light gray, and the clamps that held it together around the middle looked like a huge zipper. Dennings felt menaced by the thing he was to carry nearly 3,000 miles. The Los Alamos scientists who assembled the bomb at the airstrip had briefed Dennings and his crew the previous afternoon. A motion picture of the Trinity test explosion was shown to the young men, who sat stunned in disbelief as they viewed the awesome detonation of a single weapon with the power to crush an entire city. He stood there another half hour until the bomb bay doors were swung closed. The atom bomb was armed and secure. The plane was fueled and ready for takeoff. Dennings loved his aircraft. In the air, he and the big, complex machine became as one. He was the brain. It was the body, a unity he could never describe. On the ground, it was another story. Exposed by the shining lights and beaten by the rain that became sleet cold, he saw the beautiful ghost-like silver bomber as his crypt. He shook off the morbid thought and hurried through the rain to a Quonset hut for his crew's final briefing. He entered and sat down next to Captain Irv Stanton, the bombardier, a jolly round-faced man with a great walrus mustache. On the other side of Stanton, his feet stretched out in front of him, slouched Captain Mort Stromp, Denning's co-pilot, a complacent southerner who moved with the agility of a three-toed sloth. Immediately behind sat Lieutenant Joseph Arnold, the navigator, and Navy Commander Hank Burns, the weapons engineer, who would monitor the bomb during the flight. The briefing led off with an intelligence officer unveiling a display board showing aerial photographs of the targets. The industrial section of Osaka was the primary target. The backup, in case of heavy cloud cover, was the historical city of Kyoto. Directional bomb runs were advised as Stanton calmly made notes. A meteorology officer displayed weather charts and predicted light headwinds with scattered clouds over the targets. He also warned Dennings to expect turbulence over northern Japan. Just to be on the safe side, two B-29s had taken off an hour earlier to scout ahead and report visual assessments of weather over the flight route and cloud cover above the targets. Dennings took over as polarized welder's goggles were passed around. "I won't give you a locker room pep talk," he said, noting the relieved grins on the faces of his crew. "We've had a year of training crammed into one short month, but I know we can pull this mission off. In my humble opinion, you're the best damned flight crew in the Air Force. If we all do our jobs, we may well end the war." Then he nodded at the base chaplain, who offered a prayer for a safe and successful flight. As the men filed out toward the waiting B-29, Dennings was approached by General Harold Morrison, special deputy to General Leslie Groves, head of the Manhattan Bomb Project. Morrison studied Dennings for a moment. The pilot's eyes showed a weariness around the edges, but they glowed with anticipation. The general held out his hand. "Good luck, Major."
"Thank you, sir. We'll get the job done."
"I don't doubt it for a second," said Morrison, forcing a confident expression. He waited for Dennings to reply, but the pilot had gone silent. After a few awkward moments, Dennings asked, "Why us, General?" Morrison's smile was barely visible. "You want to back out?"
"No. My crew and I will see it through."
"But why us?" he repeated. "Excuse me for saying, sir, but I can't believe we're the only flight crew in the Air Force you'd trust to fly an atomic bomb across the Pacific, drop it in the middle of Japan, and then land at Okinawa with little more than fumes in the fuel tanks."
"It's best you know only what you've been told."
"So we can't give away top secrets if we're captured and tortured," Dennings said evenly. The general's eyes turned grim.
"You and your crew know the score. Each of you were issued a lethal capsule of cyanide.
Open wide and swallow, should any of us survive a crash over enemy territory," Dennings recited coldly. "Why not jettison the bomb at sea? At least we'd stand a chance of being picked up by the Navy."
Morrison shook his head solemnly. "The slightest possibility of the weapon falling into enemy hands is unthinkable."
"I see," Dennings murmured. "Then our other choice, if we're hit by flak or fighters over the Japanese mainland, is to ride it down and detonate rather than waste it."
Morrison stared at him. "This is not a kamikaze attack. Every conceivable measure has been carefully planned to safeguard the lives of you and your crew. Trust me, son. Dropping mother's breath on Osaka will be a piece of cake." Dennings almost believed him. For a brief instant, he came within a hair of buying Morrison's convincing line, but he read foreboding in the older man's eyes and voice.
"Mother's breath." Dennings repeated the words slowly, without tone, as one would repeat the name of some unspeakable terror. What warped soul came up with such a cockamamie code name for the bomb?
Morrison made a resigned shrug. "I believe it was the president."
27 minutes later, Dennings gazed past the beating windscreen wipers. The rain had increased, and he could see only 200 yards through the wet gloom. Both feet pressed the brakes as he ran the engines up to 2,200 RPMs. Flight engineer Sergeant Robert Mosley reported number 4 outboard engine turning over 50 revolutions slow. Dennings decided to ignore the report. The damp air was no doubt responsible for the slight drop. He pulled the throttles back to idle. In the co-pilot's seat to the right of Dennings, Mort Stromp acknowledged the control tower's clearance for takeoff. He lowered the flaps. Two of the crew in the waist turrets confirmed the flap setting. Dennings reached over and switched on the intercom.
"Okay, guys, here we go."
He eased the throttles forward again, compensating for the tremendous torque by slightly advancing the left engines over those on the right. Then he released the brake. Fully loaded at 68 tons, Dennings' demons,
her tanks filled to their filler caps with over 7,000 gallons of fuel, her forward bomb bay holding a 6-ton bomb and carrying a crew of 12, began to roll. She was nearly 17,000 pounds overweight. The four 3,350 cubic inch Wright Cyclone engines strained at their mountings, their combined 8,800 horsepower whipping the 16.5-foot propellers through the wind-driven sheet of water, blue flame erupting from exhaust manifolds, wings enveloped in a cloud of spray, the great bomber roared into the blackness. With agonizing slowness, she picked up speed. The long runway stretched out in front of her, carved out of the bleak volcanic rock and ending at an abrupt drop 80 feet above the cold sea. A horizontal bolt of lightning bathed the fire trucks and ambulances spaced along the runway in an eerie blue light. At 80 knots, Dennings took full rudder control and advanced the right engines to their stops. He gripped the wheel grimly, determined to get the demons in the air. Forward of the pilots, in the exposed nose section, Stanton the bombardier apprehensively watched the runway rapidly diminish. Even the lethargic Stromp straightened up in his seat, his eyes vainly attempting to penetrate the darkness ahead for the change in black where the runway ended and the sea began. 3/4 of the runway passed, and she was still glued to the ground. Time seemed to dissolve in a blur. They all felt as though they were flying into a void. Then suddenly the lights of the jeeps parked beside the end of the runway burst through the curtain of rain.
God almighty, Stromp blurted. Pull her up!
Dennings waited another 3 seconds and then he gently eased the wheel toward his chest. The B-29's wheels came free. She had barely clawed 30 feet out of the sky when the runway vanished, and she struggled over the forbidding water. Morrison stood outside the warmth of the radar hut under the downpour, his four-man staff dutifully standing behind him. He watched the takeoff of Denning's demons more in his mind than his eyes. He saw little more than the lurch of the bomber as Dennings thrust the throttles forward and released the brakes before it was lost in the dark. He cupped his ears and listened to the engine's pitch diminish in the distance. The uneven sound was faint. No one but a master flight mechanic or an aircraft engineer could have caught it, and Morrison had served in both capacities during his early Army Air Corps career. An engine was slightly out of tune. One or more of its 18 cylinders was not firing continuously. Fearfully, Morrison listened for some sign the bomber was not going to lift off. If Denning's demons crashed on takeoff, every living thing on the island would be incinerated within seconds. Then the radar man shouted through the open door, "They're airborne!" Morrison exhaled a tense sigh. Only then did he turn his back on the miserable weather and walk inside. There was nothing to do now but send a message to General Groves in Washington, informing him that Mother's Breath was on her way to Japan. Then wait and hope. But down deep, the general was troubled. He knew Dennings. The man was too stubborn to turn back with a bad engine. Dennings would get the demons to Osaka if he had to carry the plane on his back. God help them, Morrison muttered under his breath. He knew with dread finality his part of the immense operation didn't stand a prayer. Gear up, ordered Dennings.
Am I ever glad to hear those words, grunted Stromp as he moved the lever.
The gear motors whined and the three sets of wheels rose into their wells under the nose and wings.
Gear up and locked.
As the airspeed increased, Dennings dropped the throttle settings to save on fuel. He waited before beginning a slow and gentle climb for altitude until the airspeed touched 200 knots. Unseen off the starboard wing, the Aleutian Island chain slowly curled northeast. They would not sight land again for 2,500 miles.
How's that number four engine? He asked Mosley.
Pulling her share, but she's running a tad hot.
Soon as we hit 5,000 feet, I'll drop her back a few RPMs.
Wouldn't hurt, Major, Mosley replied.
Arnold gave Demings the course heading they would maintain for the next 10 and a half hours.
At 4,900 feet, Dennings turned control over to Stromp. He relaxed and stared into the black sky. No stars were in sight. The plane was feeling the turbulence as Stromp threaded it through the ominous mass of thunderclouds. When they finally cleared the worst of the storm, Dennings unbuckled himself and climbed out of his seat. As he twisted around, he could see through a port window below the tunnel leading to the waist and tail section of the plane. He could just make out a piece of the bomb suspended in its release mechanism. The crawl tunnel had been narrowed to receive the immense weapon into the bomb bay and was a tight fit. Dennings wiggled through past the bomb bay and dropped down on the opposite end. Then he swung open the small airtight door and slipped inside. Pulling a flashlight from a leg pocket, he made his way along a confined catwalk running the length of the two bomb bays that had been modified into one. The weapon's huge size made for an incredibly snug fit. Its outer diameter measured less than 2 inches away from the longitudinal bulkheads. Hesitantly, Dennings reached out and touched it. The steel sides felt ice cold to his fingertips. He failed to visualize the 100,000 people it could burn to cinders within a short second, or the ghastly toll from burns and radiation. The thermonuclear temperatures or the shockwave from the Trinity test could not be sensed in a black and white movie film. He saw it only as a means of ending a war and saving hundreds of thousands of his countrymen's lives. Returning to the cockpit, he stopped and chatted with Burns, who was running through a schematic of the bomb's detonation circuits. Every so often, the ordnance expert glanced at a small console mounted above his lap. "Any chance of it going off before we get there?" asked Dennings. "Lightning strike could do it," answered Burns. Dennings looked at him in horror. "A little late with a warning, aren't you? We've been flying through the middle of an electrical storm since midnight." Burns looked up and grinned. "We could have gone up just as easily on the ground. What the hell? We made it, didn't we?" Dennings couldn't believe Burns's matter-of-fact attitude. "Was General Morrison aware of the risk?" "Better than anyone. He's been on the atomic bomb project from the beginning." Dennings shuddered and turned away. Insane, he thought. The operation was insane. It'd be a miracle if any of them lived to tell about it. 5 hours into the flight, and lighter by 2,000 gallons of expended fuel, Dennings leveled the B-29 off at 10,000 feet. The crew became more upbeat as the dawn's orange glow tinted the eastern sky. The storm was far behind them, and they could see the rolling swells of the sea and a few scattered white clouds. Dennings' Demons was cruising to the southwest at a leisurely 220 knots. Thankfully, they had picked up a light tailwind. Full daybreak showed them alone in the vast emptiness of the North Pacific Ocean. A solitary airplane going from nowhere to nowhere, Bombardier Stanton mused as he gazed absently out the windows of the nose. 300 miles from Japan's main island of Honshu, Dennings started a slow, gradual climb to 32,000 feet, the altitude at which Stanton would release the bomb on Osaka. Navigator Arnold announced they were 20 minutes ahead of schedule. At the current rate of speed, he figured they should be landing at Okinawa in a shade under 5 hours. Dennings looked at the fuel gauges. He suddenly felt cheerful. Barring a 100-knot headwind, they should make it with 400 gallons to spare. Not everyone was wallowing in good cheer. Seated at his engineer's panel, Mosley studied the temperature gauge of engine number 4. He didn't like what he read. He routinely tapped the dial with his finger. The needle twitched and wavered into the red. He crawled aft through the tunnel and stared through a port at the underside of the engine. The nacelle was streaked with oil, and smoke was trailing from the exhaust. Mosley returned to the cockpit and knelt in the narrow aisle between Dennings and Stromp. "Bad news, Major. We're going to have to shut down number 4. "You can't prod her along for a few more hours?" asked Dennings. "No, sir. She can swallow a valve and catch fire at any minute." Stromp looked over at Dennings, his face somber. "I vote we shut 4 down for a while and let it cool off."
Dennings knew Strump was right. They would have to maintain their present altitude of 12,000 feet and nurse the other three engines to keep them from overheating, then restart number four during the ascent to 32,000 feet and the bombing run. He hailed Arnold, who was bent over his navigator's board tracing the flight path. How long before Japan? Arnold noted the slight drop in speed and made a swift calculation.
1 hour and 21 minutes to the mainland.
He nodded. Okay, we'll shut number four until we need it. Even as he spoke, Stromp closed the throttle, flicked off the ignition switch, and feathered the propeller. Next, he engaged the automatic pilot. For the next half hour, everyone kept a wary eye on number four engine, while Mosley called out the temperature drop. We have landfall, announced Arnold. A small island coming up about 20 miles dead ahead. Stromp peered at it through binoculars. Looks like a hot dog sticking out of the water. Sheer rock walls, observed Arnold. No sign of a beach anywhere.
What's it called? Asked Dennings.
Doesn't even show on the map.
Any sign of life?
The Nips could be using it as an offshore warning station.
Looks barren and deserted, answered Stromp.
Dennings felt safe for the moment. No enemy ships had been sighted, and they were too far from shore to be intercepted by Japanese fighters. He settled down in his seat and stared unseeing at the sea. The men relaxed and passed around coffee and salami sandwiches, immune to the drowning engines and the tiny speck that appeared 10 miles away and 7,000 feet above their port wingtip. Unknown to the crew of Dennings' demons, they had only a few minutes to live.
Lieutenant Junior Grade Sato Okanaga saw the brief glint from the reflected sun below him. He banked and went into a shallow dive for a closer inspection. It was an aircraft, no question. A plane from another patrol, most likely. He reached for the switch to his radio, but hesitated. In a few seconds, he'd be able to make a positive identification. A young and inexperienced pilot, Okanaga was one of the lucky ones. Out of his recently graduated class of 22, who were rushed through training during Japan's desperate days, he and three others were ordered to perform coastal patrols. The rest went into kamikaze squadrons. Okanaga was deeply disappointed. He would have gladly given his life for the Emperor. But he accepted boring patrol duty as a temporary assignment, hoping to be called for a more glorious mission when the Americans invaded his homeland. As the lone aircraft grew larger, Okanaga didn't believe what he saw. He rubbed his eyes and squinted. Soon he could clearly make out the 90-foot polished aluminum fuselage, the huge 141-foot wings, and the 3-story vertical stabilizer of an American B-29. He stared, dumbfounded. The bomber was flying out of the northeast from an empty sea, 20,000 feet below its combat ceiling. Unanswerable questions fluttered his mind. Where had it come from? Why was it flying towards central Japan with one engine feathered? What was its mission? Like a shark knifing toward a bleeding whale, Okanaga closed to within a mile. Still no evasive action. The crew seemed asleep or bent on suicide. Okanaga had no more time for guessing games. The great winged bomber was looming up before him. He jammed the throttle of his Mitsubishi A6M0 against its stop and made a circling dive. The Zero handled like a swallow, the 1,130-horsepower Sakai engine hurtling him behind and beneath the sleek, gleaming B-29. Too late, the tail gunner sighted the fighter and belatedly opened fire. Okanaga squeezed the gun tit on his control stick. His Zero shuddered as his 2 machine guns and 2 20-millimeter cannons shredded metal and human flesh. A light touch of the rudder and his tracers ate their way into the wing and the B-29's number 3 engine. The cowling ripped and tore away. Oil poured through holes, followed by flames. The bomber seemed to hover momentarily, and then it flipped on its side and spun toward the sea. Only after the choked-off cry of the tail gunner and his short burst of fire did the demons realize they were under attack.
They had no way of knowing from what direction the enemy fighter had come. They barely had time to recover when the shells from the Zero ate into the starboard wing. A strangled cry came from Stromp.
"We're going in!"
Dennings shouted into the intercom as he fought to level the plane.
"Stanton, jettison the bomb! Jettison the goddamn bomb!"
The bombardier, wedged against his bomb sight by the centrifugal force, yelled back,
"It won't fall free unless you straighten us out!"
The number three engine was blazing now. The sudden loss of two engines, both on the same side, had thrown the plane over until it was standing on one wing. Working in unison, Dennings and Stromp struggled with the controls, fighting the dying aircraft to an even keel. Dennings pulled back on the throttles, leveling out but sending the bomber into a flat, sickening stall. Stanton pulled himself to an upright position and popped open the bomb bay doors.
"Hold it steady," he yelled futilely.
He wasted no time adjusting the bomb sight. He pushed the bomb release button. Nothing happened. The violent twisting motion had jammed the atomic bomb against its tight quarters. White-faced, Stanton struck the release with his fist, but the bomb stubbornly remained in place.
"It's jammed," he cried. "It won't fall free."
Fighting for a few more moments of life, knowing that if they survived, they must all take their own lives by cyanide, Dennings struggled to ditch the mortally wounded aircraft in the sea. He almost made it. He came within 200 feet of settling the demons on her belly in a calm sea. But the magnesium in the accessories and crankcase on number three engine flared like an incendiary bomb, burning through its mounts and wing spar. It dropped away, ripping away the wing control cables. Lieutenant Okanaga slipped the Zero off one wing, spiraling around the stricken B-29. He watched the black smoke and orange flame curl from the blue sky like a brushstroke. He watched the American plane crush itself into the sea, followed by the geyser of white water. He circled, searching for survivors, but saw only a few bits of floating debris. Elated at what was to be his first and only kill, Okanaga banked around the funeral pyre of smoke one last time before heading back to Japan and his airfield. As Dennings' shattered aircraft and its dead crew settled into the seabed 1,000 feet beneath the surface, another B-29 in a later time zone and 600 miles to the southeast set up for its bomb run. With Colonel Paul Tibbetts at the controls, the Enola Gay had arrived over the Japanese city of Hiroshima. Neither flight commander was aware of the other. Both men thought only their aircraft and crew were carrying the first atomic bomb to be dropped in war. Dennings' demons had failed to make its rendezvous with destiny. The stillness of the deep seabed was as silent as the cloud that settled over the event. The heroic attempt by Dennings and his crew was buried in bureaucratic secrecy and forgotten. Part 1. Big John. 1. October 3rd, 1993. Western Pacific Ocean. The worst of the typhoon had passed. The mad thrashing seas had subsided, but the waves still climbed the bows and came green and leaden over the decks, leaving a welter of foam behind. The thick black clouds broke apart and the wind died to a gusty 30 knots. To the southwest, shafts of sunlight broke through, painting blue circles on the tumbling swells. Braving the winds and spray, Captain Arne Korvold stood on the open bridge of the Norwegian Rindal Line's passenger cargo liner Narvik and aimed his binoculars at a huge ship wallowing dead in the whitecaps. She was big, a Japanese auto carrier by the look of her. Her upper work stretched from blunt bow to a perfectly squared stern, like a rectangular box laid horizontal. Except for the bridge and the crew's quarters on the upper deck, there were no ports or windows on her sides. She seemed to have a 10-degree permanent list, but rolled to 20 as the swells smashed into her exposed port broadside. The only sign of life was a wisp of smoke from her stack. Korvold grimly noted that her lifeboats had been launched, and a sweep of the restless sea failed to find any sign of them.
He refocused the binoculars and read the English name spelled out beneath the Japanese characters on the bow. She was called the Divine Star. Korvold returned to the comfort of the central bridge and leaned into the communications room.
Still no response.
The radio operator shook his head.
Nothing. Not a peep since we sighted her. Her radio must be closed down. Impossible to believe they abandoned ship without a distress call.
Korvold stared silently through the bridge windows at the Japanese ship drifting less than a kilometer off his starboard rail. Norwegian by birth, he was a short, distinguished man who never made a hurried gesture. His ice-blue eyes seldom blinked, and his lips beneath the trimmed beard seemed constantly frozen in a slight smile. 26 years at sea, mostly in cruise ships, he had a warm and friendly disposition, respected by his crew and admired by the passengers. He tugged at his short, graying beard and swore quietly to himself. The tropical storm had unexpectedly swung north onto his course and put him nearly 2 days behind schedule on his passage from the port of Busan, Korea, to San Francisco. Korvold had not left the bridge for 48 hours, and he was exhausted. Just as he was about to take a welcome rest, they sighted the seemingly derelict Divine Star. Now he found himself faced with an enigma and a time-consuming search for the Japanese car carrier's boats. He was also burdened with the responsibility of 130 passengers, most seasick to the gills, who were in no mood for a benevolent rescue operation. "Permission to take a boarding crew across, Captain." Korvold looked up into the sculpted Nordic face of Chief Officer Oscar Steen. The eyes that stared back were a darker blue than Korvold's. The chief officer stood lean and as straight as a light pole, skin tanned and hair bleached blonde from exposure to the sun. Korvold didn't immediately answer, but walked over to a bridge window and gazed down at the sea separating the two ships. From wave crest to trough, the waves were running 3 to 4 meters. "I'm not of a mind to risk lives, Mr. Steen. Better we wait until seas calm a bit. I've taken a boat through worse. No hurry. She's a dead ship, dead as a body in the morgue. And from the look of her, her cargo has shifted and she's taking on water. Better we leave her be and search for her boats." "There may be injured men over there," Steen persisted. Korvold shook his head. "No captain would have abandoned ship and left injured crewmen behind. No captain in his right senses, maybe. But what kind of a man would desert a sound ship and lower boats in the midst of a 65-knot gale typhoon without sending a mayday signal?" "A mystery, all right," Korvold agreed. "And there's her cargo to consider," Steen continued. "Her waterline indicates a full load. She looks capable of transporting over 7,000 automobiles. Korvold gave Steen a shrewd look. "You thinking salvage, Mr. Steen?" "Yes, sir, I am. If she's totally abandoned with a full cargo, and we can sail her into port, our salvage claim should be equal to half her value or better. The company as well as the crew could share in 500 or 600 million kroner. Korvold considered for a few moments, a tantalizing thought of greed wrestling with a deep feeling of foreboding. Greed won out. "Pick your boarding crew, and include the assistant engineer. If there's smoke from her funnel, her machinery must still be in working order." He paused. "But I still prefer you wait for the water to settle." "No time," Steen announced flatly. "If her list increases another 10 degrees, we may be too late. I'd better go quickly." Captain Korvold sighed. He was going against his better judgment. But it also occurred to him that once the Divine Star's situation was known, every salvage tug within 1,000 miles would come full speed toward their position, like tow truck operators flocking to a highway accident. Finally, he shrugged. "When you're assured none of the Divine Star's crew is on board and you can get her underway, report back and I'll begin a search for her boats." Steen was gone almost before Korvold finished speaking. He assembled his men and was lowered down into the swirling water within 10 minutes. The boarding party consisted of himself and 4 seamen, the assistant chief engineer, Olaf Anderson, and the communications man, David Sakagawa, the only crewman on board the Narvik who could speak Japanese. The seamen were to probe the vessel while Anderson examined the engine room. Steen was to take formal possession of the auto carrier if it was found abandoned. With Steen at the helm, the double-ender launch plowed through the heavy seas, struggling over the crests of the waves that threatened to swamp her before plunging down into the troughs. The big Volvo marine engine growled without a miss as they bore down on the auto carrier, with the wind and sea astern of them. 100 meters from the Divine Star, they discovered they weren't alone. A school of sharks circled the listing ship, as though some inner sense told them it was going to sink and maybe leave behind some tasty scraps. The seaman at the wheel slipped the boat under the stubby bow on the lee side. It seemed to them the Divine Star was going to roll over on them with each wave that broke against her hull. When the great ship rolled down, Steen heaved up a light nylon boarding ladder with an aluminum grappling hook on one end. On the third try, the hook caught on the top edge of the bulwark and gripped. Steen scrambled up the rope ladder first and over the side. He was quickly followed by Anderson and the rest. After assembling beside the huge anchor winches, Steen led them up a fire escape-like stairway that was attached to the windowless forward bulkhead. After climbing 5 decks, they entered the largest bridge area Steen had ever seen during his 15 years at sea. After the small, efficient wheelhouse on the Narvik, this one looked as vast as a gymnasium, and yet the impressive array of electronic equipment filled only a small section in the middle. It was empty of life, but littered with charts, sextants, and other navigation equipment that spilled from open cabinets. 2 briefcases lay open on a counter as if their owners had just left the room for a short time. The Exodus appeared to be bathed in panic. Steen studied the main console.
"She's fully automated," he said to Anderson.
The chief engineer nodded.
"And then some. The controls are voice-operated. No pushing levers or giving helmsman course instructions here."
Steen turned to Sakagawa.
"Can you turn this thing on and talk to it?"
The Norwegian-born Asian leaned over the computerized console and silently studied it for several seconds. Then he pushed a pair of buttons in quick succession. The console's lights blinked on and the unit began to hum. Sakagawa looked at Steen with a slight smile.
"My Japanese is rusty, but I think I can communicate with it. Ask it to report the ship's status."
Sakagawa rattled off Japanese into a small receiver and waited expectantly. After a few moments, a male voice answered in slow, distinctive tones. When it stopped, Sakagawa stared at Steen blankly.
"It says the sea cocks are open, and the flood level in the engine room is approaching 2 meters. "Order it to close them," snapped Steen.
After a short exchange, Sakagawa shook his head.
"The computer says the sea cocks are jammed open. They can't be shut off by electronic command."
"Looks like I've got my work cut out," said Anderson. "I'd better get down there and get them turned off, and tell that damned robot to start the pumps."
While he spoke, he motioned for 2 of the seamen to follow him, and they disappeared down a companionway on a dead run toward the engine room. 1 of the remaining seamen came up to Steen, his eyes wide in shock and face as white as plaster.
"Sir, I found a body. I think it's the radio man."
Steen hurried into the communications room. An almost shapeless corpse sat in a chair hunched over the radio transmitter panel. He might have been a human when he stepped on board the Divine Star. Not now. There was no hair, and but for the fully exposed teeth where the lips had been, Steen couldn't have told whether he was looking at the front or back. The pathetic abhorrence looked as though his skin had been blistered off and the flesh beneath burned and partially melted. Yet there wasn't the slightest indication of excessive heat or fire. His clothes were as clean and pressed as though he'd just put them on. The man seemed to have burned from within.
2.
The horrible stench and the shocking sight staggered Steen. It took him a full minute to recover. Then he pushed the chair with its hideous owner off to one side and leaned over the radio. Fortunately, the digital frequency dial was labeled in Arabic numerals. After a few minutes of trial and error, he found the correct switches and hailed Captain Korvold on the Narvik. Korvold answered immediately.
"Come in, Mr. Steen," he replied formally. "What have you discovered?"
"Something sinister has happened here, Captain. So far, we've found a deserted ship with one body, that of the radio operator, who was burned beyond recognition."
"Is there fire on board?"
"No sign. The computerized automated control system shows only green lights on its fire warning systems."
"Any indication as to why the crew took to the boats?" asked Korvold.
"Nothing obvious. They seem to have left in a panic after attempting to scuttle the ship."
Korvold's mouth tightened. His knuckles turned ivory as he squeezed the phone.
"Say again?"
"The sea cocks were turned and jammed open. Anderson is working to close them now."
"Why on earth would the crew scuttle a sound ship with thousands of new cars on board?" Korvold asked vaguely.
"The situation must be viewed with suspicion, sir. Something on board is abnormal. The body of the radio operator is ghastly. He looks like he was roasted on a spit. Do you wish the ship's doctor to come over?"
"Nothing the good doctor can do here except perform a post-mortem."
"Understood," replied Korvold. "I'll remain on station for another 30 minutes before I leave to search for the missing boats."
"Have you contacted the company, sir?"
"I've held off until you're certain none of the original crew is alive to challenge our salvage claim."
"Finish your investigation. As soon as you're satisfied the ship is deserted, I'll transmit a message to our company director, notifying him of our taking possession of the Divine Star."
"Engineer Anderson is already at work closing the seacocks and pumping her dry. We have power and should be underway shortly."
"The sooner the better," said Korvold. "You're drifting toward a British oceanographic survey vessel that's holding a stationary position."
"How far?"
"Approximately 12 kilometers.
"They're safe enough."
Korvold could think of little else to say. At last, he said simply,
"Good luck, Oscar. Make port safely."
And then he was gone. Steen turned from the radio, his eyes avoiding the mutilated body in the chair. He felt a cold shudder grip him. He half expected to see the spectral captain of the Flying Dutchman pacing the bridge. There was nothing as morbid as a deserted ship, he thought grimly. He ordered Sakagawa to hunt up and translate the ship's log. The two remaining seamen he sent to search the auto decks while he systematically went through the crew's quarters. He felt as though he was walking through a haunted house. Except for a few bits of scattered clothing, it looked like the crew might return at any minute. Unlike the mess on the bridge, everything seemed lived in and ordinary. In the captain's quarters, there was a tray with two teacups that had miraculously failed to fall on the deck during the storm, a uniform laid out on the bed, and a pair of highly polished shoes side by side on the carpeted deck. A framed picture of a woman and three teenage sons had dropped flat on a neat and clean desk. Steen was hesitant to pry into other men's secrets and their memories. He felt like an uninvited intruder. His foot kicked something lying just under the desk. He leaned down and picked up the object. It was a 9mm pistol, a double-action Austrian Steyr GB. He pushed it into the waistband of his trousers. The chiming of a wall-mounted chronometer startled him, and he swore he felt his hair rise. He finished his search and beat a quick path back to the bridge. Sakagawa was sitting in the chart room, his feet perched on a small cabinet, studying the ship's log.
"You found it," said Steen.
"In one of the open briefcases." He turned back to the opening pages and began to read. "Divine Star, 700 feet, delivered March 16, 1988, operated and owned by the Tsushima Steamship Company Limited, home port, Kobe. On this voyage, she's carrying 7,288 new Murmoto automobiles to Los Angeles."
"Any clues as to why the crew abandoned her?" Steen asked.
Sakagawa gave a puzzled shake of his head. "No mention of disaster, plague, or mutiny. No report of the typhoon. The last entry is a bit odd. Read it. Sakagawa took a few moments to be sure his translation of Japanese characters into English was reasonably correct. The best I can get out of it is weather deteriorating, seas increasing, crew suffering from unknown illness, everyone sick including captain, food poisoning suspected. Our passenger, Mr. Yamada, a most important company director, demands we abandon and sink ship during hysterical outburst. Captain thinks Mr. Yamada has suffered nervous breakdown and has ordered him placed under restraint in his quarters. Steen looked down at Sakagawa, his face expressionless. That's all. The final entry, said Sakagawa. There is no more. What's the date? October 1st. That's 2 days ago. Sakagawa nodded absently. They must have fled the ship shortly after. Damned funny they didn't take the log with them. Slowly, unhurriedly, Steen walked into the communications room, his mind trying to make sense out of the final log entry. Suddenly he stopped and reached out to support himself in the doorway. The room seemed to swim before his eyes and he felt nauseous. Bile rose in his throat, but he forced it down. Then, as quickly as the attack came, it passed. He walked unevenly over to the radio and hailed the Narvik. This is First Officer Steen calling Captain Korvold. Over. Yes, Oscar, answered Korvold. Go ahead. Do not waste time on a search effort. The Divine Star's log suggests the crew left the ship before they were struck by the full force of the typhoon. They departed nearly 2 days ago. The winds would have swept them 200 kilometers away by now. Providing they survived. An unlikely event. All right, Oscar. I agree. A search by the Narvik will be useless. We've done all that can be expected of us. I've alerted American sea rescue units at Midway and Hawaii and all vessels in the general area. Soon as you regain steerage way, we'll resume course for San Francisco. Acknowledged, Steen replied. I'm on my way to the engine room to check with Anderson now. Just as Steen finished transmitting, the ship's phone buzzed. This is the bridge.
Mr. Steen, said a weak voice.
Yes? What is it?
Seaman Arn Midgard, sir. Can you come down to see cargo deck right away? I think I've found something.
Midgard's voice stopped abruptly, and Steen could hear the sounds of retching. Midgard, are you sick?
Please hurry, sir.
Then the line went dead. Steen yelled at Sakagawa. What button do I push for the engine room? There was no reply. Steen stepped back into the chart room. Sakagawa was sitting there, pale as death, breathing rapidly. He looked up and spoke, gasping the words with every breath.
The fourth button rings the engine room.
What's wrong with you? Steen asked anxiously.
Don't know. I feel awful. Vomited twice.
Hang on, snapped Steen. I'll gather up the others. We're getting off this death ship. He snatched the phone and rang the engine room. There was no answer. Fear fluttered his mind. Fear of an unknown that was striking them down. He imagined the smell of death pervading the whole ship. Steen took a swift glance at a deck diagram that was mounted on a bulkhead, then leaped down the companionway 6 steps at a time. He tried to run toward the vast holds containing the autos, but a nausea cramped his stomach and he weaved through the passageway like a drunk through a back alley. At last, he stumbled through the doorway onto sea cargo deck. A great sea of multicolored automobiles stretched 100 meters fore and aft. Amazingly, despite the buffeting from the storm and the list of the ship, they were all firmly in place. Steen shouted frantically for Midgard, his voice echoing from the steel bulkheads. Silence was his only reply. Then he spotted it, the oddity that stood out like the only man in a crowd holding aloft a sign. One of the cars had its hood up. He staggered between the long rows, falling against doors and fenders, bruising his knees on the protruding bumpers. As he approached the car with the open hood, he shouted again. Anyone here? This time he heard a faint moan. In 10 paces he had reached the car and stared frozen at the sight of Midgard lying beside one tire. The young seaman's face was festered with running sores. Froth mixed with blood streamed from his mouth. His eyes stared unseeing. His arms were purple from bleeding beneath the skin. He seemed to be decaying before Steen's eyes. Steen sagged against the car, stricken with horror. He clutched his head between his hands in helplessness and despair, but noticing the thicket of hair that came away when he dropped them to his sides. "Why in God's name are we dying?" he whispered, seeing his own grisly death mirrored by Midgard. "What is killing us?"
3. The deep-sea submersible Old Gert hung suspended beneath a large crane that sat on the stern of the British oceanographic vessel Invincible. The seas had calmed enough to launch Old Gert for a scientific probe of the seafloor 5,200 meters below, and her crew were following a tight sequence of safety checks. There was nothing old about the submersible. Her design was the latest state of the art. She was constructed by a British aerospace company within the past year and was now poised for her maiden test dive to survey the Mendocino Fracture Zone, a great crack in the Pacific Ocean floor extending from the coast of Northern California halfway to Japan. Her exterior was a complete departure from other aerodynamic submersibles. Instead of one cigar-shaped hull with a pregnant pod attached beneath, she had 4 transparent titanium and polymer woven spheres connected by circular tunnels that gave her the appearance of a jack from a child's game. One sphere contained a complex array of camera equipment, while another was filled with air and ballast tanks and batteries. The third held the oxygen equipment and electric motors. The fourth sphere, the largest, sat above the other 3 and housed the crew and controls. Old Gert was built to withstand the immense pressures found at the deepest parts of the world's seabeds. Her support systems could keep a crew alive for 48 hours, and she was powered to travel through the black abyss at speeds up to 8 knots. Craig Plunkett, the chief engineer and pilot for Old Gert, signed the last of the checkoff forms. He was a man of 45 or 50, with graying hair combed forward to cover his baldness. His face was ruddy and his eyes a medium brown with a bloodhound droop. He had helped design Old Gert and now treated her as his own private yacht. He pulled on a heavy woolen sweater against the expected chill from the cold bottom water and slipped his feet into a pair of soft fur-lined moccasins. He descended the boarding tunnel and closed the hatch behind him. Then he dropped into the control sphere and engaged the computerized life support systems. Dr. Raul Salazar, the expedition's marine geologist from the University of Mexico, was already in his seat adjusting a bottom sonar penetrating unit. "Ready when you are," said Salazar. He was a small dynamo with a huge mass of black hair, his movements quick, black eyes darting constantly, never staring at any one person or object for more than 2 seconds. Plunkett liked him. Salazar was the kind of man who accumulated his data with a minimum of fuss, made the right decisions without clouding the facts, and was accustomed to engineering a deep-sea probe from more of a business viewpoint than an academic project. Plunkett glanced at the empty seat on the right side of the sphere. "I thought Stacy was on board." "She is," answered Salazar without turning from his console. "She's in the camera sphere making a final check on her video systems." Plunkett bent over the tunnel leading to the camera sphere and found himself staring at a pair of sweat-socked feet. "We're ready to launch," he said. A feminine voice, accompanied by a hollow tone, came back. "Be finished in a sec." Plunkett eased his feet under his control panel and was settling into his low, half-reclining seat when Stacy Fox wiggled her way backwards into the control sphere. Her face was flushed from working nearly upside down. Stacy wasn't what you'd call disturbingly attractive, but she was pretty. Her long, straight blonde hair fell around her face, and she often tossed it back with a brief shake of the head. She was slim, and her shoulders were broad for a woman. The crew could only speculate about her breasts. None had ever seen them, of course, and she always wore loose-fitting sweaters. But occasionally, when she yawned and stretched, her chest gave an indication of firm substance. She looked younger than her 34 years. Her eyebrows were thick, her eyes wide apart, irises reflecting a soft pale green. The lips above a determined chin easily parted in a bright, even-toothed smile, which was almost constant. Stacy was once a golden California beach girl, majoring in the photographic arts at the Chouinard Institute in Los Angeles. After graduation, she migrated around the world recording marine life that had never been captured on film. Twice married, twice divorced, with one daughter living with her sister, her presence on board Old Gert to photograph the deep ocean was actually a cover for a more demanding assignment. As soon as she gained her seat on the right side of the sphere, Plunkett signaled an okay. The crane operator nudged the submersible down a slanted ramp through the ship's open stern and gently lowered it into the sea. The chop had died, but the swells still rolled past from 1 to 2 meters high. The crane man timed the entry so Old Gert touched a wave crest and continued into the trough, where she settled and rose in perfect sequence with the swells. The lift cables were electronically released, and several divers made a last-minute check of the exterior. 5 minutes later, the surface controller, a jolly Scot by the name of Jimmy Knox, reported to Plunkett that the sub was cleared for descent. The ballast tanks were flooded, and Old Gert quickly passed under the sparkling sea and began her trip to the bottom. Though Old Gert was the newest submersible off the drawing boards, she still descended by the old tried-and-true system of filling ballast tanks with seawater. For rising to the surface, variable-sized iron weights were dropped to increase buoyancy, because current pump technology could not overcome the opposing pressures at great depths. To Stacy, the long fall through the vast liquid void came like a hypnotic trance. One by one, the spectral colors from the scattered light on the surface faded until they finally vanished into pure black. Except for their separate control consoles mounted around the inner diameter of the sphere, they had an unobstructed 180-degree view ahead. The transparent polymer with the thin threading of titanium made vision equal to that of the resolution on a large-screen television set. Salazar paid no attention to the blackness or the occasional luminescent fish that swam outside. He was more concerned about what they would find on the bottom. Plunkett monitored the depth and the life support instruments, watching carefully for any bugs as the pressure increased and the temperature dropped with every passing moment. The Invincible carried no backup submersible in case of an emergency. If disaster unexpectedly occurred and they somehow became wedged in rocks or the equipment malfunctioned, preventing Old Gert's return to the surface, they could jettison the control sphere and allow it to sail to the surface like a giant bubble. But it was a complex system never tested under high-pressure conditions. A failure here, and they had no hope for rescue. Only the certainty of death by suffocation and a lost grave deep in the eternal night of the abyss. A small eel-like fish slithered past, its luminous body giving off flashes of light as though a stream of traffic was passing around a series of curbs. The teeth were incredibly long in proportion to his head and fanged like a Chinese dragon's. Fascinated with the interior light of the submersible, it swam up to the control sphere unafraid and cast a ghostly eye inside. Stacy aimed her battery of still and video cameras and caught it in 7 lenses before it was gone. "Can you imagine that thing if it was 20 feet long?" she murmured in awe. "Fortunately, black dragons live in the depths," said Plunkett. "The pressure of deep water prevents them from growing more than several centimeters." Stacy hit the exterior lights, and the blackness was suddenly transformed into a green haze. The void was empty. No life was to be seen. The black dragon was gone. She turned off the lights to conserve the batteries. The humidity rose inside the sphere, and the increasing cold began to seep through the thick walls. Stacy watched the goosebumps rise on her arms. She looked up, clutched her shoulders with her hands, and made a shivering gesture. Plunkett caught the signal and turned on a small heating unit that barely held off the chill. The 2 hours it took to reach the bottom would have passed tediously if everyone hadn't been busy at their own jobs. Plunkett found a comfortable position and watched the sonar monitor and the echo sounder.
He also kept a wary eye on the electrical and oxygen level gauges. Salazar kept busy plotting their probe grid once they reached the bottom, while Stacy kept trying to catch the denizens of the deep off guard with her cameras. Plunkett preferred the strains of Johann Strauss for stereo background music, but Stacy insisted on using her New Age music in the cassette player. She claimed it was soothing and less stressful. Salazar called it waterfall music, but went along. Jimmy Knox's voice from The Invincible sounded ghostly as it filtered down on the underwater acoustic telephone.
"Bottom in 10 minutes," he announced. "You're closing a bit fast."
"Righto," replied Plunkett. "I have it on sonar."
Salazar and Stacy turned from their work and stared at the sonar screen. The digital enhancement showed the seabed in contoured 3D. Plunkett's gaze darted from the screen into the water and back again. He trusted the sonar and computer, but not ahead of his own vision.
"Be on your guard," Knox alerted them. "You're dropping alongside the walls of a canyon."
"I have it," returned Plunkett.
The cliffs plunge into a wide valley. He reached for a switch and dropped one of the ballast weights to slow the descent. 30 meters from the bottom, he dropped one more, giving the submersible almost perfect neutral buoyancy. Next, he engaged the 3 thrusters mounted on the outer ends of the lower spheres. The bottom slowly materialized through the jade gloom into a broken, uneven slope. Strange black rock that was folded and twisted into grotesque shapes spread as far as they could see.
"We've come down beside a lava flow," said Plunkett. "The edge is about 1 kilometer ahead. After that, it's another 300-meter drop to the valley floor."
"I copy," replied Knox.
"What are all those wormy rocks?" asked Stacy.
"Pillow lava," answered Salazar. "Made when fiery lava strikes the cold sea. The outer shell cools, forming a tube through which the molten lava keeps flowing."
Plunkett kicked in the altitude positioning system that automatically kept the submersible 4 meters above the bottom slope. As they glided across the scarred features of the plateau, they spotted the trails of deep crawlers in scattered pools of silt, perhaps from brittle stars, shrimp, or deep-dwelling sea cucumbers that lurked in the darkness beyond the lights.
"Get ready," said Plunkett. "We're about to head down."
A few seconds after his warning, the bottom dropped away into blackness again, and the sub nosed over and fell deeper, maintaining its distance of 4 meters from the steep drop of the canyon walls.
"I have you at 5360 meters, echoed Knox's voice over the underwater phone.
"Righto, I read the same," replied Plunkett.
"When you reach the valley floor," said Knox, "you'll be on the plain of the fracture zone."
"Stands to reason," Plunkett muttered, his attention focused on his control panel, computer screen, and a video monitor now showing the terrain below old Gert's landing skids. "There's no bloody place left to go." 12 minutes passed, and then a flat bottom loomed up ahead and the sub leveled out again. Underwater particles swirled by the sphere, driven by a light current like flakes of snow. Ripples of sand stretched in front of the circular lit pattern from the lights. The sand was not empty. Thousands of black objects, roundly shaped like old cannonballs, littered the seabed in a thick layer.
"Manganese nodules," explained Salazar, as though tutoring. "No one knows exactly how they formed, although it's suspected shark's teeth or whale ear bones may form the nucleus."
"They worth anything?" asked Stacy, activating her camera systems.
"Besides the manganese, they're valued for smaller quantities of cobalt, copper, nickel, and zinc. I'd guess this concentration could run for hundreds of miles across the fracture zone and be worth as high as $8 million a square kilometer."
"Providing you could scoop it up from the surface, 5.5 kilometers away," Plunkett added.
Salazar instructed Plunkett on what direction to explore as old Gert soared silently over the nodule-carpeted sand. Then something gleamed off to their port side. Plunkett banked slightly toward the object.
"What do you see?" asked Salazar, looking up from his instruments.
Stacy peered downward.
"A ball!" she exclaimed.
"A huge metal ball with strange-looking cleats. I'd guess it to measure 3 meters in diameter." Plunkett dismissed it. Must have fallen off a ship. Not too long ago, judging from their lack of corrosion, commented Salazar. Suddenly they sighted a wide strip of clear sand that was totally devoid of nodules. It was as though a giant vacuum cleaner had made a swath through the middle of the field.
A straight edge, exclaimed Salazar.
There's no such thing as prolonged straight edges on the seafloor. Stacy stared in astonishment.
Too perfect. Too precise to be anything but man-made.
Plunkett shook his head.
Impossible. Not at this depth. No engineering company in the world has the capability to mine the abyss. And no geological disturbance I ever heard of could form a clean road across the seabed, stated Salazar firmly.
Those indentations in the sand that run along the borders look like they might match that huge ball we found.
Okay, muttered Plunkett skeptically. What kind of equipment can sweep the bottom this deep?
A giant hydraulic dredge that sucks up the nodules through pipes to a barge on the surface, theorized Salazar. The idea has been tossed around for years. So has a manned flight to Mars, but the rocketry to get there has yet to be built, nor has a monster dredge. I know a lot of people in marine engineering, and I haven't heard even a vague rumor about such a project. No mining operation of this magnitude can be kept secret. It'd take a surface fleet of at least 5 ships and thousands of men working for years, and there is no way they could pull it off without detection by passing ships or satellites.
Stacy looked blankly at Salazar.
Any way of telling when it happened?
Salazar shrugged.
Could have been yesterday. Could have been years ago.
But who then?
Stacy asked in a vague tone.
Who is responsible for such technology?
No one immediately answered. Their discovery did not fit accepted beliefs. They stared at the empty swath with silent disbelief, a fear of the unknown trickling down their necks. Finally, Plunkett gave an answer that seemed to come distantly, from outside the submersible.
No one on this earth.
No one who is human.
4. Steen was entering into a state of extreme emotional shock. He stared numbly at the blisters forming on his arms. He trembled uncontrollably, half mad from the shock and a sudden abdominal pain. He doubled over and wrenched, his breath coming in great heaves. Everything seemed to be striking him at once. His heart began beating erratically, and his body burned up with fever. He felt too weak to make it back to the communications compartment and warn Korvold. When the captain of the Norwegian ship received no replies from his signals to Steen, he would send another boarding party to see what was wrong. More men would die uselessly. Steen was drenched in sweat now. He stared at the car with the raised hood and his eyes glazed with a strange hatred. A stupor descended over him, and his crazed mind saw an indescribable evil in the steel, leather, and rubber. As if in a final act of defiance, Steen took vengeance against the inanimate vehicle. He pulled the Steyr automatic he'd found in the captain's quarters from under his waistband and raised the barrel. Then he squeezed the trigger and pumped the bullets into the front end of the car. 2 kilometers to the east, Captain Korvold was staring through his binoculars at the Divine Star when she blew herself out of existence, vaporizing in the final blink of his eyes. A monstrous fireball erupted with a blue brilliance whose intensity was greater than the sun. White-hot gases instantly burst over an area 4 kilometers in diameter. A hemispherical condensation cloud formed and spread out like a vast donut, its interior quickly burned out by the fireball. The surface of the sea was beaten down in a great bowl-like depression 300 meters across. Then an immense column consisting of millions of tons of water rose into the sky, its walls sprouting thousands of horizontal geysers, each as large as the Narvik. The shockwave raced from the fireball like an expanding ring around Saturn, speeding outward with a velocity approaching 5 kilometers a second. It struck the Narvik, pulping the ship into a formless shape. Korvold, standing in the open on the bridge wing, did not see the holocaust. His eyes and brain had no time to record it.
He was carbonized within a microsecond by thermal radiation from the explosion's fireball. His entire ship rose out of the water and was tossed back as if struck down by a giant sledgehammer. A molten rain of steel fragments and dust from the Divine Star cascaded the Narvik's shattered decks. Fire burst from her ruptured hull and engulfed the shattered vessel, and then explosions deep in her bowels. The containers on her cargo deck were tossed away like leaves before a gust from a hurricane. There was no time for hoarse, tortured screams. Anyone caught on deck flared like a match, crackled, and was gone. The entire ship became an instant funeral pyre to her 250 passengers and crew. The Narvik began to list, settling fast. Within 5 minutes of the explosion, she rolled over. Soon only a small portion of her bottom was visible, and then she slid under the agitated waters and vanished in the depths. Almost as suddenly as the Divine Star evaporated, it was over. The great cauliflower-shaped cloud that had formed over the fireball slowly scattered and became indistinguishable from the overcast. The shimmering fury of the water calmed, and the surface smoothed but for the rolling swells. 12 kilometers across the sea, the Invincible still floated. The incredible pressure of the shockwave had not yet begun to diminish when its full force smashed into the survey ship. Her superstructure was gutted and stripped away, exposing interior bulkheads. Her funnel tore from its mountings and whirled into the boiling water as the bridge disappeared in a violent shower of steel and flesh. Her masts were bent and distorted. The big crane used to retrieve old Gert was twisted and thrown on one side. The hull plates saucered inward between her frame and longitudinal beams. Like the Narvik, the Invincible had been beaten into a formless shape that was almost unrecognizable as a ship. The paint on her sides had blistered and blacked under the fiery blast. A plume of black, oily smoke billowed from her smashed port side and lay like a boiling carpet over the water around her hull. The heat bored right through anyone exposed in the open. Those below decks were badly injured by concussion and flying debris. Jimmy Knox had been thrown violently into an unyielding steel bulkhead, bouncing backward and gasping for air as if he was in a vacuum. He wound up flat on his back, spread-eagled, staring up stunned through a gaping hole that appeared as if by magic in the ceiling. He lay there waiting for the shock to pass, struggling to concentrate on his predicament, wondering in a fog what had happened to his world. Slowly he gazed around the compartment at the bent bulkheads, seeing the heavily damaged electronic equipment that looked like a robot with its guts pulled out, smelling the smoke from the fires, and he felt the hysteria of a child who had lost his parents in a crowd. He looked through the slash above into the bridge housing and chart room. They had been gutted into a tortured skeleton of deformed beams. The wheelhouse was a smoldering shambles that was now a crypt for burned and broken men whose blood dripped into the compartments below. Knox rolled to his side and groaned in sudden agony caused by 3 broken ribs, a twisted ankle, and a sea of bruises. Very slowly, he pushed himself to a sitting position. He reached up and adjusted his glasses, surprised they had remained perched on his nose during the incomprehensible devastation. Slowly, the dark curtain of shock parted, and his first thought was of old Gert. Straight from a nightmare, he could see the submersible damaged and out of contact in the blackness of the deep. He crawled across the deck in a daze on hands and knees, fighting back the pain, until he could reach up and grasp the receiver to the underwater telephone.
"Gert," he burst out fearfully. "Do you read?"
He waited several seconds, but there was no reply. He swore in a low monotone.
"Damn you, Plunkett. Talk to me, you bastard."
His own answer was silence. All communications between the Invincible and old Gert were broken. His worst fears were realized. Whatever force had battered the survey ship must have traveled through the water and mangled the submersible that was already subjected to incredible pressures.
"Dead," he whispered, "crushed to pulp."
His mind suddenly turned to his shipmates, and he called out. He heard only the groan and screech of metal from the dying ship. He moved his eyes to the open doorway and focused on five bodies sprawled in untidy, stiff attitudes, like cast-off display mannequins. He sat fixed in grief and incomprehension. Dimly, he felt the ship shudder convulsively, the stern slipping around and sliding beneath the waves as though caught in a whirlpool. Concussions reverberated all around him. The Invincible was about to take her own journey to the abyss. The urge to live surged within him, and then Knox was scrambling up a slanted deck, too dazed to feel the pain from his injuries. Charging in panic through the door to the crane deck, he dodged around the dead bodies and over the devastated steel equipment that sprawled everywhere. Fear took the place of shock and built to a tight, expanding ball inside him. He reached the twisted remains of the railing. Without a backward glance, he climbed over and stepped into the waiting sea. A splintered piece of a wooden crate bobbed in the water a few meters away. He swam awkwardly until he could clasp it under one arm and float. Only then did he turn and look at the Invincible. She was sinking by the stern, her bows lifting above the Pacific swell. She seemed to hang there for a minute, sailing toward the clouds as she slipped backward at an ever-increasing speed and disappeared, leaving a few bits of flotsam and a cauldron of churned water that soon subsided into a few bubbles, tinted in rainbow colors by the spilled oil. Frantically, Knox searched the sea for other members of the Invincible's crew. There was an eerie hush now that the groans of the sinking ship had passed. There were no lifeboats, no heads of men swimming in the sea. He found himself the only survivor of a tragedy that had no explanation. 5. Beneath the surface, the shockwave traveled through the incompressible water at roughly 6,500 kilometers per hour in an expanding circle, crushing all sea life in its path. Old Gert was saved from instant destruction by the canyon walls. They towered above the submersible, shielding it from the main force of the explosive pressure. Yet the submersible was still whirled about violently. One moment it was level, the next it was tumbled end over end like a kicked football by the turbulence. The pod containing the main batteries and propulsion systems struck the rock-like nodules, cracked and collapsed inward from the tremendous pressure. Fortunately, the hatch covers on each end of the connecting tube held, or the water would have burst into the crew's sphere like a pile driver and mashed them into bloody paste. The noise of the explosion came over the underwater telephone like a thunderclap, almost in unison with the express train rumble from the shockwave. With their passing, the deep returned to a beguiling silence. Then the calm was broken again by the screech and groan of tortured metal as the ravaged surface ships fell through the deep, buckling and compressing before plunging against the seafloor in great mushroom clouds of silt. "What is it?" Stacy cried, clutching her chair to keep from being thrown about. Whether from shock or radical devotion to his work, Salazar's eyes had never left his console. "This is no earthquake. It reads as a surface disturbance." With the thrusters gone, Plunkett lost all control of old Gert. He could only sit there in helpless detachment as the sub was tossed across the field of manganese nodules. Automatically, he shouted into the underwater telephone, skipping all call sign formalities. "Jimmy, we are caught in unexplained turbulence. Have lost our thrust pod. Please respond." Jimmy Knox could not hear. He was fighting to stay alive in the waves far above. Plunkett was still trying desperately to raise the Invincible when the submersible finally ended her erratic flight and struck the bottom on a 40-degree angle, coming to rest on the sphere surrounding the electrical and oxygen equipment. "This is the end," Salazar murmured, not really knowing what he meant, his mind mired in shock and confusion. "The hell it is," snapped Plunkett. "We can still drop ballast weights and make it to the top." He knew as he spoke that releasing all the iron ballast weights might not overcome the added weight of the water within the shattered pod, plus the suction from the muck. He activated the switches, and hundreds of pounds of dead weight dropped free from the submersible's underbelly. For a few moments, nothing happened. Then, centimeter by centimeter, old Gert pulled herself from the bottom, rising slowly as if pushed by the hushed breaths and pounding hearts of the three people inside her main sphere.
10 feet up, announced Plunkett after what seemed an hour, but in reality was only 30 seconds.
Old Gert leveled out and they all dared to breathe again. Plunkett futilely kept trying to contact Jimmy Knox.
Jimmy, this is Plunkett. Talk to me.
Stacy stared so hard at the depth meter she thought the glass over the dial would crack.
Go. Go, she pleaded.
Then their worst nightmare burst on them without warning. The sphere holding the electrical and oxygen equipment suddenly imploded. Weakened by its impact into the seafloor, it gave up its integrity and was crushed like an egg by the merciless pressure.
Bloody hell,
Plunkett gasped as the sub dropped back into the silt with a jarring bump. As if to drive home the terrifying reverse, the lights blinked out and snapped the sphere into a world of pure ebony. The malignancy of the Stygian blackness is a horror only the totally blind experience. To those with sight, the sudden disorientation curses the mind into believing unspeakable forces are approaching from beyond in an ever-tightening circle. At last, Salazar's hoarse voice broke the silence.
Mother of Jesus, we're finished for good.
Not yet, said Plunkett. We can still make it to the surface by jettisoning the control sphere.
His hand groped over his console until his fingers touched a particular switch. With an audible click, the auxiliary lights came on and relit the interior of the sphere. Stacy sighed with relief and briefly relaxed.
Thank heaven. At least we can see.
Plunkett programmed the computer for an emergency ascent. Then he set the release mechanism and turned to Stacy and Salazar.
Hold tight. It may be a rough trip topside.
Anything to get the hell out of here, grunted Salazar.
Whenever you're ready,
Stacy said gamely. Plunkett removed the safety peg from the release handle, took a firm grip, and pulled. Nothing happened. 3 times Plunkett feverishly ran through the routine, but the control sphere stubbornly refused to detach from the main section of the sub. In desperation, he turned to the computer to troubleshoot the cause of the malfunction. An answer came back in the blink of an eye. The release mechanism had been twisted and jammed by the angled impact with the seabed, and there was no way to repair it.
I'm sorry,
Plunkett said in frustration, but it looks like we stay until rescued.
Fat chance of that, snapped Salazar,
wiping the sweat that poured from his face with the sleeve of a down ski jacket.
How do we stand on oxygen? Asked Stacy.
Our main supply was cut off when the pod imploded, replied Plunkett. But our emergency canisters in this unit and the lithium hydroxide scrubber to remove our exhaled carbon dioxide should keep us sucking air for 10 to 12 hours.
Salazar shook his head and gave a defeated shrug.
Every prayer in every church of the world won't save us in time. It'll take a minimum of 72 hours to get another submersible on site, and even then it's doubtful they could lift us to the surface.
Stacy looked into Plunkett's eyes for some small sign of encouragement, but she found none. He wore a remote and distant look. She got the impression he was saddened more by the loss of his precious submersible than he was at the prospect of dying. He came back on track as he became aware of her stare.
Raoul is right, he said tautly. I hate to admit it, but we'll need a miracle to see the sun again.
But the invincible, said Stacy.
They'll move heaven and earth to reach us.
Plunkett shook his head.
Something tragic happened up there. The last sound we heard was a ship breaking up on her way to the bottom.
But there were 2 other ships in sight when we left the surface, Stacy protested. It might have been either one of them.
It makes no difference,
Plunkett said wearily.
There is no way up. And time has become an enemy we cannot defeat.
A deep despair settled in the control sphere. Any hope of rescue was a fantasy. The only certainty was a future salvage project to retrieve old Gert and their bodies long after they were dead. 6.
Dale Nichols, special assistant to the president, puffed on his pipe and peered over his old-style reading spectacles as Raymond Jordan entered his office.
Jordan managed to smile despite the sickly sweet tobacco fumes that hung in the office like smog under an inversion layer. Good afternoon, Dale.
Still raining? Asked Nichols.
Mostly turned to drizzle.
Jordan noted that Nichols was under pressure. The protector of the presidential realm was an efficient operator, but the thicket of coffee-brown hair looked like a hayfield in a crosswind. The eyes darted more than usual, and there were tension lines in the face Jordan had never seen before.
The president and the vice president are waiting, said Nichols quickly.
They're most anxious to hear an update on the Pacific Blast.
I have the latest report, Jordan said reassuringly.
Though he was one of the five most powerful men in official Washington, Jordan was not known to the general public, nor was he familiar to most bureaucrats or politicians. As director of Central Intelligence, Jordan headed the National Security Service and reported directly to the president. He lived in a spectral world of espionage and intelligence, and there were very few outsiders who were aware of the disasters and tragedies from which he and his agents had saved the American people. Jordan did not strike a stranger as a man with a brilliant intellect who possessed a photographic memory and was conversant in seven languages. He seemed as ordinary-looking as his men and women in the field. Medium height, late 50s, healthy head of silver-gray hair, solid frame with slight paunch, kindly oak-brown eyes. A faithful husband to his wife of 37 years. They had twin daughters in college, both studying marine biology. The president and vice president were engaged in quiet conversation as Nichols ushered Jordan into the Oval Office. They turned instantly and faced Jordan, who observed that they were as uptight as the president's special assistant.
Thank you for coming, Ray, said the president without fanfare, nervously motioning to a green couch beneath a portrait of Andrew Jackson. Please sit down and tell us what in hell is going on out in the Pacific.
Jordan always found himself amused by the painful uneasiness that gripped politicians during an impending crisis. No elected official had the seasoned toughness and experience of career men such as the Director of Central Intelligence, and they could never bring themselves to respect or accept the immense power Jordan and his counterparts possessed to control and orchestrate international events. Jordan nodded to the president, who towered a good head above him, and sat down. Calmly, with what seemed to the others agonizing slowness, he set a large leather accountant-style briefcase on the floor and spread it open. Then he pulled out a file as a reference.
Do we have a situation? The president asked impatiently, using the formal watchword for an imminent threat to the civilian population, such as a nuclear attack.
Yes, sir. Unfortunately, we do.
What are we looking at?
Jordan glanced at the report purely for effect. He'd already memorized the entire 30 pages.
At precisely 11:54 hours, an explosion of great force took place on the North Pacific, approximately 900 kilometers northeast of Midway Island. One of our perimeter spy satellites recorded the flash and atmospheric disturbance with cameras and recorded the shock wave from clandestine hydrophonic buoys. The data was transmitted directly to the National Security Agency, where it was analyzed. This was followed by readings from seismographic array stations linked to NORAD, who in turn relayed the information to CIA technicians at Langley. And the conclusion, the president pushed.
They agreed the explosion was nuclear, he said calmly. Nothing else could be that massive.
Except for Jordan, who seemed as relaxed as if he was watching a soap opera on television. The expressions of the other three men in the Oval Office looked positively grim at the abhorrent thought that was finally thrown out in the open.
Are we on DEFCOM alert? Inquired the president, referring to the scale of nuclear readiness.
Jordan nodded.
I've taken the liberty of ordering NORAD to go immediately to a DEFCON 3 alert with standby and staging for DEFCON 2, depending on reaction by the Soviets.
Nichols stared at Jordan. Are we airborne?
A Casper SR-90 recon aircraft took off from Edwards Air Force Base 20 minutes ago to verify and collect additional data.
Are we certain the shockwave was caused by a nuclear explosion? Asked the vice president, A man in his early 40s who had only spent 6 years in Congress before being tapped for the number two job. The consummate politician, he was out of his depth on intelligence gathering.
It might have been an underwater earthquake or volcanic eruption.
Jordan shook his head. The seismographic recordings showed a sharp pulse associated with nuclear detonations. The reflection from an earthquake goes back and forth for a longer length of time. Computer enhancement confirms that fact. We should have a good idea of the energy in kilotons after the Casper collects atmospheric radiation samples.
Any guesses?
Until all the data is in. The best guess is between 10 and 20 kilotons.
Enough to level Chicago, Nichols murmured.
The president was afraid to ask the next question, and he hesitated.
Could it have been one of our own nuclear submarines that blew up?
The chief of naval operations assures me none of our vessels were within 500 kilometers of the area.
A Russian, maybe?
No, Jordan replied. I've notified my USSR counterpart, Nikolai Golonov. He swore all Soviet nuclear surface ships and submarines in the Pacific are accounted for, and quite naturally blamed us for the event. Though I'm 100% sure he and his people know better, they won't admit they're in the dark as much as we are.
I'm not familiar with the name, said the vice president. Is he KGB?
Golunov is the director of foreign and state security for the Politburo, Jordan explained patiently.
He could be lying, offered Nichols.
Jordan shot him a hard look. Nikolai and I go back 26 years together. We may have danced and shined, but we never lied to one another.
If we aren't responsible, and neither are the Soviets, mused the president, his voice gone strangely soft, then who is?
At least 10 other nations have the bomb, said Nichols. Any one of them could have run a nuclear bomb test.
Not likely, answered Jordan.
You can't keep the preparations a secret from global bloc and Western intelligence gathering. I suspect we're going to find it was an accident, a nuclear device that was never meant to go off.
The president looked thoughtful for a moment, and then he asked, Do we know the nationality of the ships in the blast area?
All the details aren't in yet, but it appears that 3 vessels were involved, or at least innocent bystanders. A Norwegian passenger cargo liner, a Japanese auto carrier, and a British oceanographic ship that was conducting a deep-bottom survey.
There must have been casualties.
Photos from our satellite before and after the event show that all 3 ships had vanished and were presumed sunk during or immediately after the blast. Human survivability is very doubtful. If the fireball and shockwave didn't get them, the heavy radiation will in a very short time.
I take it a rescue mission is planned, said the vice president.
Naval units from Guam and Midway have been ordered to the site.
The president stared at the carpet steadily, as if seeing something.
I can't believe the British were secretly conducting a bomb test without notifying us. The Prime Minister would have never gone behind my back.
Certainly not the Norwegians, said the Vice President firmly.
The President's face made a mystified expression.
Nor the Japanese. There's no evidence they ever built a nuclear bomb.
The device might have been stolen, suggested Nichols, and clandestinely transported by the unsuspecting Norwegians or Japanese.
Jordan shrugged offhandedly. I don't think it was stolen. I'm willing to bet a month's pay an investigation will prove it was deliberately being carried to a scheduled destination.
Which was?
One of 2 California ports.
They all looked at Jordan in cold speculation, the enormity of the whole thing growing in their minds.
The Divine Star was bound from Kobe to Los Angeles with over 7,000 Morimoto automobiles, Jordan continued.
The Narvik, carrying 130 passengers and a mixed cargo of Korean shoes, computers, and kitchen appliances, sailed from Busan for San Francisco.
The president grinned mildly.
That should put a small dent in the trade deficit.
Good God, muttered the vice president, shaking his head. A frightening thought.
A foreign ship smuggling a nuclear bomb into the United States.
What do you recommend, Ray? Demanded the president.
We dispatch field teams immediately, preferably Navy deep-sea salvage vessels, to survey the sunken ships and learn which ship was transporting the bomb.
The president and Nichols exchanged knowing glances. Then the president stared at Jordan.
I think Admiral Sandecker and his ocean engineering people at NUMA are better suited for deep water operation. I'll leave it to you, Ray, to brief him.
If I may respectfully disagree, Mr. President, we can keep a tighter security lid on the event with the Navy.
The president gave Jordan a smug look. I understand your concern, but trust me, the National Underwater and Marine Agency can do the job without a news leak. Jordan rose from the couch, professionally annoyed that the president knew something he didn't. He made a mental note to dig at his first opportunity.
If Dale will alert the admiral, I'll leave for his office immediately.
The president extended his hand.
Thank you, Ray. You and your people have done a superb job in so short a time.
Nichols accompanied Jordan as he left the Oval Office to head for the NUMA building. As soon as they were in the hallway, Nichols asked in a low voice, just between you and me and the furniture, who do you think is behind the bomb smuggling? Jordan thought for a moment and then replied in an even disquieting tone.
We'll know the answer to that within the next 24 hours. The big question, the one that scares the hell out of me, is why and for what purpose?
7. The atmosphere inside the submersible had become rank and humid. Condensation was dripping from the sides of the sphere, and the carbon dioxide was rising into the lethal range. No one stirred and seldom spoke to conserve air. After 11.5 hours, their life-preserving oxygen supply was nearly gone, and what precious little electrical power was left in the emergency batteries could not operate the CO2 scrubbing unit much longer. Fear and terror had slowly faded to resignation. Except for every 15 minutes, when Plunkett switched on the lights to read the life support systems, they sat quietly in the dark, alone with their thoughts. Plunkett concentrated on monitoring the instruments, fussing with his equipment, refusing to believe his beloved submersible could refuse to respond to his commands. Salazar sat like a statue, slumped in his chair. He seemed withdrawn and barely conscious. Though he was only minutes away from falling into a final stupor, he could not see the point in prolonging the inevitable. He wanted to die and get it over with. Stacy conjured up fantasies of her childhood, pretending she was in another place, another time. Her past flew by in fleeting images, playing baseball in the street with her brothers, riding her new bicycle Christmas Day, going to her first high school prom with a boy she didn't like, but who was the only one who asked her. She could almost hear the strains of the music in the hotel ballroom. She forgot the name of the group, but she remembered the songs. We May Never Pass This Way Again from Seals and Crofts was her favorite. She had closed her eyes and imagined she'd been dancing with Robert Redford. She cocked her head as if listening. Something was out of place. The song she heard in her mind wasn't from the mid-1970s. It sounded more like an old jazz tune than rock. She came awake, opened her eyes, seeing only the blackness.
They're playing the wrong music, she mumbled.
Plunkett flicked on the lights.
What was that?
Even Salazar looked up uncomprehendingly and muttered,
She's hallucinating. They're supposed to be playing We May Never Pass This Way Again, but it's something else.
Plunkett looked at Stacy, his face soft with compassion and sorrow.
Yes, I hear it too. No. No, she objected. Not the same. The song is different. Whatever you say, said Salazar, panting.
His lungs ached from trying to wrest what oxygen he could from the foul air. He grabbed Plunkett by the arm.
For God's sake, man, close down these systems and end it. Can't you see she's suffering? We're all suffering.
Plunkett's chest was hurting too. He well knew it was useless to prolong the torment, but he couldn't brush aside the primitive urge to cling on to life to the last breath. "We'll see it through," he said heavily. "Maybe another sub was airlifted to the Invincible." Salazar stared at him with glazed eyes and a mind that was hanging on to a thin thread of reality.
"You're crazy. There isn't another deep water craft within 7,000 kilometers. And even if one was brought in, and the Invincible was still afloat, they'd need another 8 hours to launch and rendezvous. I can't argue with you. None of us wants to spend eternity in a lost crypt in deep ocean. But I won't give up hope."
"Crazy,"
Salazar repeated. He leaned forward in his seat and shook his head from side to side as if clearing the growing pain. He looked as though he was aging a year with each passing minute.
"Can't you hear it?" Stacy uttered in a low croaking voice. "They're coming closer." "She's crazy too," Salazar rasped.
Plunkett held up his hand.
"Quiet. I hear something too. There is something out there."
There was no reply from Salazar. He was too far gone to think or speak coherently. An agonizing band was tightening around his lungs. The desire for air overpowered all his thoughts, save one. He sat there and wished death to come quickly. Stacy and Plunkett both stared into the darkness beyond the sphere. A weird rat-tailed creature swam into the dim light coming from inside old Gert. It had no eyes, but it made a circuit of the sphere, maintaining a distance of 2 centimeters before it went on about its business in the depths. Suddenly the water shimmered. Something was stirring in the distance, something monstrous. Then a strange bluish halo grew out of the blackness, accompanied by voices singing words too garbled by the water to comprehend. Stacy stared entranced, while Plunkett's skin crawled on the back of his neck. It had to be some horror from the supernatural, he thought, a monster created by his oxygen-starved brain. There was no way the approaching thing could be real. The image of an alien from another world crossed his mind again. Tense and fearful, he waited until it came nearer, planning on using the final charge of the emergency battery to switch on the outside lights. A terror from the deep or not, he realized it would be the last thing he'd ever see on Earth. Stacy crawled to the side of the sphere until her nose was pressed against its interior. A chorus of voices echoed in her ears.
"I told you,"
she said in a strained whisper.
"I told you I heard singing. Listen."
Plunkett could just make out the words now, very faint and distant. He thought he must be going mad. He tried to tell himself that the lack of breathable air was playing tricks on his eyes and ears. But the blue light was becoming brighter, and he recognized the song. "Oh, what a time I had with Minnie the Mermaid, down at the bottom of the sea. I forgot my troubles there among the bubbles. Gee, but she was awfully good to me." He pushed the exterior light switch. Plunkett sat there motionless. He was used up and dog-weary, desperately so. His mind refused to accept the thing that materialized out of the black gloom, and he fainted dead away. Stacy was so numbed with shock she couldn't tear her eyes from the apparition that crept toward the sphere. A huge machine, moving on great tractor-like treads and supporting an oblong structure with 2 freakish manipulator arms on its underside, rolled to a stop and sat poised under the lights of old Gert. A human-like form with blurred features was sitting in the transparent nose of the strange craft, only 2 meters away from the sphere. Stacy closed her eyes tightly and reopened them. Then the vague, shadowy likeness of a man took shape. She could see him clearly now. He wore a turquoise-colored jumpsuit that was partially opened down the front. The matted black strands on his chest matched the dark, shaggy hair on his head. His face had a masculine, weathered, craggy look, and the mirth wrinkles that stretched from a pair of incredibly green eyes were complemented by the slight grin on his lips. He stared back at her with a bemused interest,
Then he reached down behind him, set a clipboard on his lap, and wrote something on a pad. After a few seconds, he tore off a piece of paper and held it up to his view window. Stacy's eyes strained to focus on the wording. It read, "Welcome to Soggy Acres. Hang on while we connect an oxygen line." Is this what it's like to die? Stacy wondered. She'd read of people going through tunnels before emerging into light and seeing people and relatives who had died in the past. But this man was a perfect stranger. Where did he come from? Before she could match the puzzle pieces, the door closed, and she floated into oblivion. 8.
Dirk Pitt stood alone in the center of a large...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.